for immigrating to the spiritual world, we need the desire, first of all. Now, where would the desire come from? So generally, say if somebody is living in some remote place, cut off from the whole rest of the world, in say in some tribal region in the heartland of India, they may not even know that there is such a big world out there. So the first step for getting any desire to go anywhere is to have knowledge. And with respect to, say, going to a country like America, you know, we can know from geography that, okay, a place like America exists. But how do we know, first of all, that something like a spiritual world exists at all? Is it just the fantasy of some people who, some religious people who imagine that there's some better world? It could be, but if we look at it in a more objective sense, we'll find that there is something existential within us which longs to live forever and to love forever. All the among the movies and novels, thousands and thousands of which are written, most of them are about romance. And most romance has within it the idea of we want to be happily ever after, isn't it? It's a, this longing is deep rooted. If you look at the Bhagavad Gita, what it tells us is this world is dukkhalayam ashashvatam. It's exactly opposite. Happily ever after, dukkhalayam ashashvatam. It's exactly opposite. And yet, we all long for something eternal. And if you consider the world around us, there is nothing in the world around us that lasts forever. So where does this longing to live forever come from? If we consider again the example of a remote tribe, say somebody is living in a tribe in the deep heartland of India, and there's no phone, no mobile phone, no internet over there, and a child is living over there, and child comes one day to the mother and says, "Mom, I want a pizza." Now, what will the mother ask? What is a pizza? Or even if she somehow knows from somewhere else, where did you hear about pizza? Isn't it? So, if there is nothing in the environment that could trigger a particular desire, because there's nothing that will provide knowledge of that knowledge for that desire, and naturally the question will come up, where does this desire come from? So if we look at the world around us, nothing lasts forever. Even the huge mountains, they also have finite lifespan. And giant skyscraper buildings, they also stay for a finite duration only. And this longing for life eternal is not just some passing desire that we have. It's a very deep-rooted desire. So another example could be that if, say, after this program gets over, and then suddenly somebody finds, while cleaning up, a golden ring fallen over here. They may look, okay, there's not many things golden in this room. So where did this golden ring come from? If something is out of place, in a particular place, then immediately the question comes, this must have come from somewhere else. There must be some other place where this thing is natural. Maybe it is a gold ore, maybe it is a jeweler shop, maybe it is someone who has a lot of golden ornaments. It's come from somewhere. So if you take these two examples together of the desire for pizza, so if something is present which doesn't come from its environment, then it must be coming from somewhere else. So our longing for the eternal in an ephemeral world points to the existence of some other world, which is eternal. This is not a conclusive proof, but it is a reasonable inference. And if we see this longing is universal across human culture. A defining difference between the pre-modern times and the modern times was that in the modern times, people started rejecting the idea of some other world. In the pre-modern times, whether it was Europe and the Christian civilization there, it was India, or whether it's the Islamic civilization in the Middle East, or the Native Americans in America, everybody had this broad understanding that this world is a place along the journey. As Jesus said, this world is like a bridge. Don't build your home on the bridge. So this idea that there is some other world beyond this world, which is where we are meant to go, that is universal in human culture. One of Srila Prabhupada's scholar disciples, Dr. Michael Cremo, the Karma Prabhu, has written a book called Human Devolution. And in that, he actually extensive research of civilizations across the world. And this point is conveyed through actual source literature, source texts of different traditions. And we may say, but today people don't believe in such a world. Yeah, that is at one level true. Most people don't believe. But what has modernity done? See, that, as I said, the defining difference between the pre-modern times and the modern times was that in the modern times, people don't believe, they don't consider that even if it is there, it doesn't matter much. The rejection or the negligence of some other world, that is a defining characteristic of the modern world. But how did this happen? Because a defining difference between pre-modern and modern times is the development of science and technology. And through technology, essentially, humanity, man, is trying to create a technological paradise. The whole idea is, in fact, there is a whole field of modern science. It is called transhumanism. Transhumanism is the field which holds that actually humanity is suffering from universal problems. The problems they say are old age, disease, birth, and death. Now, for them, birth is a problem in the sense they call it overpopulation. They're not talking about rebirth. But still, they say that. So, transhumanism is the scientific area of research by which scientists and technologists hope that in future, we will be able to remove all these problems. And then, this world will become an eternal world. In fact, the longing has been there in various forms. Even today, scientists have preserved the brain of Einstein. So they're hoping that in future, when we find out how to revive people, then we will put that brain in somebody and we'll have Einstein coming back. There are some billionaires who have actually, in their will, used use advanced technology to preserve their bodies in deep refrigeration. That in future, therefore, somebody will come and when they find out how to revive, then I'll be revived. And usually what happens, because there's one billionaire who did this, and he actually put almost 90% of his fortune to perpetuate his own body for as long as it took. And then his success, relatives, his sons and all those who expected to get an inheritance from him, they actually went to court to fight that, to argue that this is not possible. So this will is not valid and it should be broken and we should get all the money. So the point is that this desire has not been rejected. This desire has not been that. It's just been directed in a different way. So whatever religion, religious texts or traditional cultures pointed to a spiritual world at some other level of reality, we through science are trying to develop it through technology. So essentially the desire for eternal life is something which is universal everywhere. And at least we can say we can be open-minded. Maybe there is some world like that. Maybe there is some part of us which is eternal. So where does this our longing for the eternal come from? It comes from our core. The Bhagavad Gita explains that that core is eternal. So through logic, with respect to the spiritual domain, about logic, we can make some inferences. But we cannot go beyond inference. If you want further knowledge, we need the appropriate texts. So the Bhagavad Gita describes parastasmat bhavonyo vyakto vyaktat sanatanaha yasa sarveshu bhuteshu nashyatsu navinashyati. It says that beyond this world, there's another world. When everything in this world is destroyed, that part will exist as it is. And the Gita explains that we as souls belong to that world. And what is attractive about that world? It is not just that that place is eternal. As I said, there are two distinct longings. We want to live forever and we want to love forever. So these two longings, our longing to live forever points to our own eternality, points to something eternal within us which lasts forever, which lives forever. And our longing to love forever points to an eternal object of love. And the Bhagavad Gita explains that eternal object, there can be many eternal objects of love, but the supreme eternal object is God, is Krishna. The word Krishna means Sarva Akarshati Iti Krishna. One who is all attractive. This all attractive is an interesting phrase. I said, so many people are not attracted to Krishna right now. So how can we say Krishna is all attractive? Actually, when we say Krishna is all attractive, that doesn't necessarily, what it necessarily means is that everything attractive comes from Krishna. It doesn't necessarily mean everyone will be attracted to Krishna. Why is that? If we consider the earth, all energy comes from the sun. Even electricity is basically recycled sunlight. Even if we have fossil fuels also formed because of sunlight long ago. All forms of energy come from the sun. But one who doesn't have that knowledge of the sun as being the source, they may think, oh, we want hydroelectric power, we want thermal power, we want nuclear power. All these powers are there, but in the sense of science, they've all come from the sun. So similarly, what the Bhagavad Gita tells us is in 10.41, yad yad vibhutimat sattvam shrimadurjitam evava tattadeva avagachatvam mama tejo amsha sambhava. At everything attractive manifests a spark of Krishna splendor. So whatever is attractive in anyone that we find, somebody may be very good looking, somebody may be very brilliant, somebody may be very talented, somebody may be very wealthy, whatever it is that we find attractive in anyone, yes, they have that attractiveness. But that attractiveness is like a spark. And Krishna is like the whole. So whatever pleasure we may get by connecting with someone, that pleasure and much, much more we can get by connecting with Krishna. So the desire for the spiritual world is not just the desire for some place. Yes, that place is wonderful. But what makes that place wonderful is the person who presides over there. And from both these points, that our longing for eternal life and our longing for eternal love, both of them are fulfilled eternally in the spiritual world. The Bhagavad Gita describes many, many past, the Bhakti literature describes many pastimes of Krishna wherein he performs extraordinary pastimes, extraordinary reciprocations of love. When Europeans came to India during the colonial times, in the 18th century roundabout, at that time, most of them were Christians and they had that idea of God as some stern being who sits on the clouds and judges people and then sends thunderbolt down on the sinful. So one of my friends is a judge and he has a passion for justice. But still he tells me that it's a draining job. He told me if God were a judge for all of eternity, God's life would be very exhausting. This is a very difficult job description. So the Bhakti literature describes, yes, that God does oversee the world. But that is not what his primary activity is. In the spiritual world, he exists And with those who love him, he reciprocates love eternally. So when this, the colonials came to India, and they looked at, they went to North India, and they saw all these, they all saw these depictions in the walls of this sweet little, sweet looking boy with some white substance on his face, with a hand in a pot. And they asked, who is this? He said, he's God. That idea of God, old man with a beard sitting on a cloud. God, what is he doing? So he's stealing butter. They got completely intellectually short-circuited. It just didn't make any sense. Okay, God, how can he be a small child? And why does he have to, how can God steal anything? And even if somebody has to steal, why steal butter of all things? So nothing could make sense. So actually Krishna, he's God. Yes. But as the, in the spiritual world, he does not delight in demonstrating his Godhood. In demonstrating his Godhood. See, I am so great, all of you bow down to me. He actually subordinates his Godhood to his loving nature. When required, he can manifest his Godhood immediately. But there are different devotees who desire to reciprocate love with him in different ways. And for that purpose, he manifests the appropriate forms. So for those who desire to love him in the maternal mood. So for Yashoda Mai, he manifests as a small child. And as a child, he acts as the extremely endearing child. He doesn't. He will do all the things which will give his mother lots and lots to talk about, delight in remembering him, delight in speaking about him. So he is, although he's small, see, God is not limited by his smallness. Although God is big, God is not stuck with his bigness. Some people are very tall. When they're very tall, that height has an advantage. You can see above others, but it says some small roof, lower roof is there, then you get stuck over there. So, but you are tall, then you are tall. You cannot become small afterwards, isn't it? But so Krishna is not, Krishna is bigger than the biggest, but he's not stuck with his bigness. Nor is he, when he becomes small, he's not limited by his smallness. In the Damodar Leela, we will offer Arati at the end of our class today. In that Leela, Krishna as a small child breaks down two huge trees. Because he is, his strength is not limited by his form. So Krishna in the spiritual world engages in sweet loving reciprocation with his devotees. So why does he steal? And why does he steal butter? Actually, his stealing is not immoral. It is transmoral. Immoral, so morality, immorality, transmorality. Transmoral means it is above morality. Why? Because everything belongs to him. In fact, his mother and all the ladies in Vrindavan, when they churn butter, they all deem and desire to offer it to Krishna. But when Krishna goes and tries to sneak in and steal it, that simply creates more excitement for everyone. And the gopis try to catch Krishna now, and Krishna runs away. And they say, we'll make a plan and catch Krishna. And Krishna outwits them. And sometimes they outwit and catch Krishna. And when they catch Krishna, Krishna makes such a sweet and sorry face. They say, okay, you can go. So he just endears himself to everyone by his actions. And then why does he steal butter of all things? Actually, the heart is meant to be soft like butter. So when the gopis churn the milk and the curd and gradually they make butter. The idea is that we also want to churn our hearts. So Krishna stealing the butter is representative of Krishna stealing our hearts. So Krishna, he is God who is extremely attractive. And as that vision of God, if we understand the eternality of the spiritual world and the extraordinary attractiveness of Krishna, that will create within us the desire to go to the spiritual world. Let's move anymore. Slide. So now again, the desire alone is not enough. Then we need qualification. Say people want to come from the rest of the world to America, but now it seems like the American government doesn't want you to come. So they just stay out. It wants people who are very qualified only to come. So actually, Krishna is not like that. Krishna already loves us. And his love for us is based not on who we are, but who he is. What does that mean? He is like an all-loving father. He's Suhrudam Sarvabhutanam. He's the well-wisher of all living beings. One of the common adjectives used to describe Krishna is Bhakta Vatsala. What does it mean, Bhakta Vatsala? Yes, lover of his devotees. But Krishna is not just the lover of his devotees alone. In the 7th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, when Prahlad offers prayers to Vishnu, at that time he says that Krupana Vatsala Dussa Ogra. He uses the word Krupana Vatsala. My dear Lord, you are the lover, the benefactor of everyone. Krupana refers to people who are materialistic, who are so short-sighted that they don't think about life's bigger things. So Krishna is saying that he loves everyone. So it is his desire that we come to the spiritual world is actually our qualification, our fundamental qualification. But at the same time, that his desire, his love for us, because of which he desires that we come there, That is a necessary qualification, but it is not sufficient. You say, why not sufficient? Because the spiritual world is not just, going to the spiritual world is not a matter of just relocation. It is a matter of redirection. What do I mean by redirection? Before, can you go ahead? Okay, can you go ahead one more? Yeah, go behind. So actually, on the spiritual path, we are always unqualified. We are never pure enough to attain the spiritual world. But by Krishna's mercy, we are never disqualified. So what is the difference? Unqualified means we don't have the qualification to do this. But disqualified means we are not allowed to do this. We are not allowed to do it. It's not like that. Nobody is disqualified. Some people, they say that if you invite them to a temple, they say, actually, I am very impure. Says, if I come to the temple will become impure. Well, that is like saying, if somebody is very dirty and they're stinking and says, there's a nice flowing river there, please take a bath. Says, no, if I take a bath, the river will become polluted. Well, that might seem like humility. Oh, I'm so fallen. But it's not humility. It's actually, it's perverse form of pride. It's like saying that, I am so fallen, I am so degraded, I am so impure that even God can't purify me. It's not like that. That means it's just a distorted understanding. We are unqualified. Why are we unqualified? Because going to the spiritual world actually requires redirection of the heart. Suppose somebody goes to a sports stadium. A sports stadium where, say, here in India, cricket is what everybody is mad after. In America, for many people, cricket just reminds them of an insect. So maybe here people are mad after baseball. But suppose whichever game it is, say we go to a baseball stadium and everybody is cheering loudly, everybody is screaming and yelling, and we know nothing about baseball. Then, after a few minutes, like, what am I doing here? Said, if everybody is interested in baseball, we have no interest in baseball. We start looking at our watch. Maybe I want to go home, I want to watch some TV, I want to talk with my friends. Nothing to do over here. So similarly, in the spiritual world, everyone is loving Krishna. And everybody delights in talking about Krishna, in remembering Krishna. And if somehow we do get to the spiritual world, if we don't have love for Krishna, you know, we'll be the spiritual world and we'll be asking, you know, what is the stock rate, stock price? What is the score of the cricket match? What is happening in politics? So we'll be out of place over there. So it's not just a matter of going to that place. To be happy there, to be delighted, to delight in the spiritual world, we have to have love for Krishna. So in that sense, it is the qualification is not something which Krishna imposes that because you don't have this, you can't come there. It is rather without that qualification, going to the spiritual world will also not give us any satisfaction. Yes, we will feel out of place over there completely. Normally, nobody can go to the spiritual world without love for Krishna. But even if someone somehow gets there, like say in the ninth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, they describe how Durvasa Muni gets to the spiritual world. But he is there, he's not interested in glorifying Vishnu. He says, please protect me from the Sudarshan Chakra. He goes there and he comes back from there. So as long as the heart is not desiring, is not filled with love for Krishna, going to the spiritual world will not give us much happiness. That's why the qualification is that we have to develop love for Krishna. Krishna already loves us, but we need to develop the love for Krishna. Then when we have love for Krishna, then we can go to the spiritual world. Go ahead. So if you consider now the process. Now for the process, okay, say if you're going to come from India to America, you have to board a flight or you have to take, like Prabhupada came by a ship. So we have to take some means by which we can go to that place. Now, before we can actually follow a process to go to the spiritual world, we need to understand what the spiritual world is. Some, we may have sometimes a map of the universe. It is there in the Srimad Bhagavatam and other places. We say, okay, the material world is here, the spiritual world is here. Now, for the purpose of depiction, that is fine. But in reality, the spiritual world doesn't exist at the same level as the material world. So if we say, okay, this is India, and above it is China, or this is America, above it is Canada. So it's not like that, this is the material world, this is the spiritual world. You just cross over the boundary and you get to the spiritual world. The spiritual world is primarily a level, it's exists at a higher level of reality. There's physical reality, there is mental reality, there's spiritual reality. So to get to that world, it's not just a matter of geographical relocation. It's a matter of elevation of consciousness. And if that state of consciousness is there, then we can be in the spiritual world even now. In fact, in 12.8 in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Mai eva mana dhatsva mai buddhim niveshaya nivasishyasi mai eva ata urdhvam na samshayah. He says, if your mind and intelligence are fixed in me, then you are already living in me. You're already living in me. Why? Because it's just a matter of consciousness. That if somebody is absorbed in Krishna in this world itself, they have no desires to enjoy this world separate from Krishna. Then they are what is technically called as Jivan Mukta. They are liberated while even in this body. There are two kinds of Mukti in this context. There is Jivan Mukti and there is Videha Mukti. Videha means without the body. So at the end of our life, we leave this material body behind and then we go to the spiritual world literally also. But even before that happens, if somebody is absorbed in Krishna, then they are already detached from the world and they are already having Jivan Mukti. So the process for going to the spiritual world centers on absorption in Him. Strive for absorption in Krishna. With our mind and intelligence, we try to remember Krishna. We try to absorb ourselves in Krishna. And how do we absorb ourselves in Krishna? We say, okay, we come to some satsang, we hear some classes. That time we feel, maybe we are remembering Krishna. But then we have to take care of our family responsibilities. We have to work. We have to earn money. And that time we have to think of so many things. So what does absorption in Krishna mean? Actually, for absorption in Krishna, we need to understand that Krishna is not just our destination. He's also our companion. Say, suppose you take a flight from India to come to America. And in America, there is a contact, an acquaintance, a very important person. whom you're going to meet over there. But say if this was 20, 30 years ago when technology was not so advanced, we didn't have any photographs of people also. So then we had never seen that person. And they sit in the flight, we come all the way to America, and then we maybe going to meet some, we're going to get some education. So we go to the university, we go to the professor's door and knock on the professor's door and then open the door. And we see that sitting there, that inside the door is the same person who was sitting right next to us throughout our flight. But because we didn't know who we were looking for, so we didn't recognize. So similarly, Krishna as the Paramatma is present right now with us. Sarvasya chaham rudisan nivishto. Sarvasya chaham. In the hearts of everyone, Krishna says, I am present. So he is our companion right now during our journey also. In fact, Krishna is closer than the closest person to us can ever be. Even if the person who loves us the most hugs us the tightest of hugs, still that person can't come as close to us as Krishna always is. So Krishna is close to us, but we are far away from him. Why is that? Because our consciousness is turned away from him. Krishna is close to us. But when we turn away, we don't see him. We're looking at this world and we are caught in this world. So Sevon Mukhe Hijivadav Swayam Eva Spuratyadaha. So by doing seva, by serving Krishna, Unmukha, we have become Vimukha from Krishna, our face has turned away from Krishna. But when we render service to Krishna, by that service we become Unmukha, we turn towards him. And when we turn towards him, what happens by that? Swayam Eva Spuratyadaha. Krishna reveals himself as a Spurti, as a divine revelation within us. So this striving for absorption, it means that right now, when we understand it, how do I remember Krishna? Understand Krishna is there with me all the time. So when we face difficulties in life, when we face struggles in life, when we feel tempted or threatened in life, at that time we remember Krishna. Krishna, please help me. Krishna, I want to focus on you. I want to love you. I want to serve you. That prayerful attitude itself can connect us with Krishna. And the process, so there are two broad ways of cultivating absorption in Krishna. One is we could call it as exclusive devotion. The other is inclusive devotion. Exclusive devotion means we focus directly on devotional activities. So we chant the holy name, we do our japa, we do our, we come for satsang, we do our puja, we do some swadhyaya, we study scriptures. So by all this, we focus directly on Krishna. But the very nature of our life is that we can't do this constantly. We have many other responsibilities. And during that time, we understand that devotion is also inclusive. Inclusive means that whatever activities we are doing in life, we do them in a mood of service to Krishna. So if we are doing our work, we see that the abilities that I have are gifts from Krishna. Paurusham drishu. This is Krishna. Krishna says, I am ability in human beings. So what does it mean, I am ability in human beings? Actually, whatever abilities we have, we find that it's not that we have those abilities constantly. Say in a sport like cricket, some batsman might be a very talented batsman. And one day that person is just hitting every ball with a flourish to the boundary. But the next day that person just gets out for a straight ball. You may say, what has happened? He went out of form. Now, what do you mean by out of form? Nobody wants to go out of form, isn't it? So we see our own abilities are not always with us. Sometimes they are there with us and sometimes they're not there. You know, I, among all the scriptures, I connect with the Bhagavad Gita quite well. So I've memorized quite a few verses. Sometimes you would ask me, have you memorized all the verses of the Gita? And I have found without fail it happens, the day I say yes, the next time when I'm giving a class, I forget a verse. So actually, to have ability is a gift. To have ability is a gift. But to realize that we have ability, that is a greater gift. Sometimes we may have abilities, we don't even know that we have those abilities. But to realize that our ability is a gift, that is the greatest gift. To have ability is a gift. To realize that we have ability is a greater gift. But to realize that our ability is a gift, that is the greatest gift. So we all, when we work in our particular field, at our particular jobs, we have an ability, we have certain intelligence, certain resources, certain talents which we are using. So when using those talents, if you remember, this talent, it is not that when I was born, either my parents or I did some programming in the womb by which I got this ability. It's a gift that came to me. So then this gift has come from Krishna. So even while working in the world, if we think that our abilities are given by Krishna to us, we can still be conscious of Krishna. Krishna says, Swakarmana tamabhyarcha. Work in a mood of worship to me. Now some people oversimplify it and say this work is worship. Now work is worship is good as an ethical principle by which we can infuse all work with dignity of labor. Don't look down on any people. As an ethical principle, it is fine. But as a philosophical principle, if we say work is worship, then the donkey will become the greatest worshipper. Donkey works so much. Now, work is not worship. That is not the Bhagavata's teaching. Krishna is not saying, the Bhagavata never says karma hi puja hai, as is commonly thought. What it says is swakarmana tamabhyarcha. By your work, worship him. So work is to be done in a mood of worship. And that mood of worship comes when we understand that our abilities are gifts from Krishna and we are meant to use those abilities in a mood of service. Similarly, our family responsibilities. Instead of seeing our family members simply as our family members, we see them as Krishna's parts. And Krishna has entrusted their care to us. And when we do that family responsibility in a mood of service to Krishna, that is inclusive devotion. So Vishwanath Chakravarti gives an example of how this inclusive devotion works. He says that suppose somebody is working at a job which is far away from their home, staying in a different city entirely. Now, while they are working there, they may practically dealing with their clients, they are doing taking care of all the logistics, but in their heart they're thinking that I'm doing this for my family, for my children. So they are externally doing various things, but because of their affection for their family members, internally they're aware, all this is for my family. So similarly, Vishwanath Thakur says that when we develop affection for Krishna, a devotee may be engaged in many different kinds of work in the world, but internally the devotee is absorbed in Krishna. So that recollection of Krishna comes primarily by our intention. As I'm doing this in a mood of service to Krishna. And gradually as we keep doing it, then initially when we do something, say for the first time we speak in public, at that time we are so conscious, do I look good? How are people looking at me? What will people think of me? What is this place? We're so conscious of externals. But if we develop a habit of public speaking, then over a period of time, the externals, we are aware of them, but they go to the background of our awareness. And we focus on, okay, what am I speaking? So that content will come to the foreground. For many people, there is stage fright. Stage fright means they're completely normal, but as soon as they get on stage, they get fearful. Why? Because they're so conscious of that stage, of the external. But for those who are regular speakers, then the stage fright doesn't come that much because they're not so much conscious of the stage. They're conscious of what they are speaking on the stage. Similarly for us, in the initial stages of bhakti, Krishna may be in remote background of our awareness. We may be like, oh, I have to do this job, I have to get this done, I have to get this, I have to do that. That's true. But if we keep doing bhakti, as I talk about exclusive devotion, that means we give quality time to Krishna and connect with him. By the practice of bhakti, our affection for Krishna develops. By our japa, by our satsanga, by our swadhyaya, mam ichhaptum dhananjaya. The ichha for Krishna, that develops. And then as the desire for Krishna develops, then when we are doing inclusive devotion also, We're doing other activities, but our affection for Krishna will ensure that at the background, at least, Krishna will be there in our memory. And gradually, as we keep doing this, Krishna will start coming from the background to the foreground. And thus, we will cultivate absorption in Krishna. Those devotees who were with Srila Prabhupada, they told Istaka a few days working on a new book, and I was helping in some kind of reviewing and editing of the book. So he's writing a book about Prabhupada in Juhu, how Prabhupada built a Juhu temple. So it's a huge 800 page book. So he was telling that when he observed Prabhupada, whether Prabhupada is speaking with four or five people in his private darshan, or when he was speaking in a pandal program with 20,000, 30,000 people. He says, when Prabhupada started speaking about Krishna, he had the same energy and enthusiasm. Because for him, the important thing was glorifying Krishna. So that occasion one is aware of, but that is not in the foreground of the consciousness. In the foreground is Krishna. That's how the absorption Krishna comes. So the process is, we strive for absorption Krishna through exclusive devotion and inclusive devotion combined. Go ahead. Now, what is the attitude we can have? Let's say sometimes we may feel that, oh, this is so bhakti, so difficult. But actually speaking, if you see that we have already come to Krishna's lotus feet, in the sense that we have come in the association of devotees, we have started practicing bhakti. And how did we get here? It is, if we see there are many saints who leave the world in search of God. Many of Srila Prabhupada's disciples are also like that. They left the whole world and they went across traveling and searching for God. At least for me, I didn't go searching for God. It is God's devotees who came searching for me. For most of us, it is like that. Somebody distributes a book, somebody invites us for a program. And most of us come quite reluctantly. So if Krishna has got us so far, it is not because of any strong desire on our part. He has brought us so far in spite of ourselves. It is not because of ourselves, it is in spite of ourselves. We practice, we are distracted in our devotion, we are half-hearted in our devotion. But still, Krishna has got us a long, long way away. If we look at our life, say 20 years ago, 30 years ago, and now, those of us who are practicing bhakti, we see there's a significant difference in our life. And we may say, I have endeavored in bhakti. Yes, we all have endeavored. But one test we can have is how much have we endeavored? Is that sometimes when we feel like chanting, we chant. Sometimes we don't feel like chanting, we just drag along inattentively. But if we say that if we are working for our family or for our profession, when our boss asks us to do some work, now we don't tell the boss, "Aaj mood nahi hai. I don't feel like doing it today." Now we make our devotion so dependent on our moods. If I don't feel like doing it, why should I do it? But our job, we don't leave it dependent on our moods. So why should Krishna get less from us than what our boss gets? And if you look at our own life, we do give Krishna a lot less than what we give our boss. So that's why it is in spite of ourselves that Krishna has got us this far. And actually speaking, it is that Krishna has a plan and we have to cooperate with this plan. So actually Krishna will take us to the spiritual world. We just have to get out of his way. Get out of his way means stop obstructing him. Stop diverting ourselves. So if we just practice the process of bhakti, he will take us all along the way. He has a plan for us and he is eager for us to come to him. So that's why if we look at ourselves and think, oh, I have so many attachments, I have so many doubts, I have so many distractions, how can I practice bhakti? But if we look at the world, we will get discouraged. But if we look at Krishna, we will become encouraged. Yes, Krishna is with me. It is Krishna's potency that will take me. In fact, the Bhagavad Gita setting also demonstrates this. That as long as Arjuna was looking at the battlefield, he was looking at the world, he lost his will to fight. But when he turned towards Krishna, and not just looked at Krishna, but heard from Krishna, then his will to fight came back. So similarly for us, in the world we live in, this world is the world of Maya, of illusion. So generally speaking, illusion comes through our eyes and illumination comes through our ears. So if we keep hearing about Krishna, we keep hearing illumination comes through the ears. So we will understand Krishna's love, Krishna's benevolence, and we'll be able to move forward with a positive, hopeful attitude if we just stay, if we direct our vision towards Krishna, that is through hearing. And the last part is that when we are practicing bhakti, be not fretful or fearful, be faithful. So fretful means, oh, this went wrong in my life, that went wrong in my life, that person did like that. There are so many things which we can lament about. Sometimes some people are so negative, they keep feeling sorry for themselves. And then two or three people who feel sorry for themselves come together, then they have what is called a pity party. Oh, you know, life is so bad. Yeah, life is so bad. This happened to me. Ah, this happened to me. Oh, this person did like that. This person did like that. And they just, by feeling sorry for themselves, they all go down deeper and deeper and deeper. Yes, bad things have happened in our life. But if we are honest, good things have also happened in our life. There are many, there are some countries in Africa where the lifespan itself is around 40, 45 years. So many of us are above that age. So the very fact that we are alive means something good has happened in our life. Otherwise, we wouldn't even be alive. So yes, bad things have happened in the past, but good things have also happened. So Krishna is so expert that even through our mistakes, his plan can work. Even if we have committed some mistakes, Krishna doesn't hold those mistakes against us. Krishna is like the ultimate GPS. If you are driving a car, and then the GPS tells us turn right and we turn left. And then GPS says, get lost now. No, GPS doesn't do that. It says rerouting. It reroutes and tells us how to come back. So like that, even if in the past we have made some mistakes, some bad things have happened to us, Krishna's plan can work even through our mistakes. So that's why there's no need to be fretful. Generally, we fret about the past. And about the future, we may be fearful. What if this goes wrong? What if that goes wrong? What if that goes wrong? Now, we can't know what the future holds. But we do know who holds the future. We can't know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. Vedaham samatitani vartamanani cha arjuna bhavishyani cha bhutani mam tu vedana kashchana. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita 7th chapter that I know past, present and future. So Krishna, even if whatever comes in our life in the future, Krishna will be with us and he will guide us through. So all that we need to be is be faithful. Be faithful means we do our part in our service to Krishna. We take small steps and Krishna will do his part. Krishna will take care of things. We have to do our part. We have to serve. We have to endeavor. But we don't have to worry about things that are beyond our control. Krishna will take care of those things. When bad things happen in our life, at that time, rather than getting obsessed over them, oh, what if this happens? What if that happens? Why did this happen? We can understand that through it all, Krishna is with me. And bad things happen to us, we understand that from a philosophical perspective, it's because of karma. We all have to understand the karma because of which bad things happen to us. But whatever karma may get us to, Krishna will get us through. Whatever karma may get us to, Krishna will get us through. So if we just stay devoted to Krishna, Krishna will take us all the way from through this journey in this world beyond to his eternal abode. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. The theme of immigrating to the spiritual world. I started by talking about how people's desire to immigrate to another country, say to America, is often greater than our devotees, our desire to attain the spiritual world. So how can we intensify that So we reflected four broad considerations. What are the first? What is required for going to the spiritual world?
Desire.
Yes. So we talked about desire in two ways. One is as a logical inference. Everything around us is temporary, but still we have a desire for the eternal. Everything around us is, nobody lives forever, but at the same time, we want to live forever and love forever. Just like a African child desiring a pizza, or we seeing gold on a stone floor. This out of place desire points to some other place. So our desire to live forever points to our own eternality as souls. Our desire to love forever points to Krishna's eternality as an all-attractive object of love. And what logic points towards that scripture illuminates. Krishna is all-attractive. That means that everything attractive that anyone has, it is present in him. It's just like the sun is the source of all energy, Krishna is the source of all attractiveness. And by getting attracted to various objects in this world, we may get a little pleasure. But by getting attracted to Krishna, we'll get eternal pleasure. And Krishna in the spiritual world is not a judge punishing the wrongdoers. He's simply a lover who delights in the reciprocation of love with his devotees. That's why he subordinates his godhood so that he can take a small baby-like form. And he steals butter to simply steal the heart and endear himself to his devotees. And the qualification, that is the second part. So it is Krishna wants us to come. So in that sense, a big part is already done. Krishna's love for us is based not on who we are, but on who he is. He is not just Bhakta Vatsala, but also Krupana Vatsala. Simultaneously, if we do not love Krishna, then we'll be out of place in the spiritual world. Everybody is like, if we go to a sports stadium and we're not interested in the sports, we'll feel out of place. So we need to develop love for Krishna so that we can be happy in the spiritual world. And for that, we need to redirect our heart. So we may not have love for Krishna, we may not have purity like Krishna has. So we are unqualified, but we are never disqualified. Krishna always wants us to come to him. And a third was, after desire, then qualification and process. The process we discuss is not a physical relocation, but it's a redirection of consciousness. The spiritual world is not just a different region at a different location. It exists a different level of reality. And the essence of that consciousness is absorption in Krishna. So how do we cultivate that absorption? By a combination of exclusive devotion, in which we do the bhakti activities by which our desire for Krishna develops. And then inclusive devotion, in which we do our professional activity, our various activities, when whatever abilities we are using in those activities, we see those abilities are gifts from Krishna. We work in a mood of worship to him. Our family responsibilities we do, but in the understanding that these are not my family members alone, they are Krishna's family members. Just like a person staying away from home thinks about the family while doing all the work. Similarly, if we have developed affection for Krishna, then even while we engage in worldly activities, our intention will be our connection with Krishna. Through the intention, the recollection will happen. And as we keep doing exclusive devotion more and more, then Krishna will move from the background of our awareness to the foreground. And thus our remembrance will become more and more steady and more deep. And the last part was attitude. So we feel Krishna is so far away, bhakti is so difficult. But actually, Krishna has got us so far in spite of ourselves. We hardly went out searching for Krishna. It is Krishna who came, Krishna who sent his devotees searching for us. And we are often half-hearted in our devotion. We leave it to our moods. Krishna, we often give to Krishna far less than what we give to our boss. But still Krishna has got a long way away. So if we just keep cooperating with Krishna, then Krishna will take us all the way to all the way. Krishna is not just far away as a destination, he's close to us as our companion also. And if we start worrying about, lamenting about the past, then be not fretful. Krishna can bring good even out of the bad. Krishna, even if we have committed some mistakes, Krishna is the ultimate GPS who will reroute and get us to the destination. And if we start fearing the future, we understand Krishna holds the future. So whatever karma may get us to, Krishna will get us through. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. any comments or questions?
Yes, first, I want to get this clear. The exclusive is your japa, your meditation.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, japa, study of scripture, puja, the direct devotional activities.
Okay. And along those lines, so you mentioned that we have to get out of the way of Krishna, that we are obstructing.
Yeah.
Can you maybe give some practical examples and say more about that?
Okay, what does it mean to get out of the way of Krishna?
Yeah,
I would say that it's two things. First is that it is our mind which comes in the way of Krishna. It's like, say, somebody offers us a delicious glass of sweet rice to drink. And then we put it to our mouth and we're drinking it. But suddenly somebody comes and pushes our mouth. And the sweet rice all falls over our body, but we don't get to taste any of it. So what is happening? The sweet rice is coming, but we are not able to taste it because it is not going into our mouth. So similarly for us, Krishna is here, our consciousness is here. If we can just connect with Krishna, Krishna is relishable. But our mind comes along and pushes our consciousness elsewhere. We're chanting Hare Krishna, and I'm like, what about this? What about that? What about that? What about that? When the mind distracts us, we don't connect with Krishna. So when we say we have to get out of the way, that simply means we have to stop being so attached to the mind. That whatever the mind says, we go along with that. And thus we, when Krishna is coming in our lives, we actually obstruct Krishna by going off with our mind. Now there's a Maharashtrian saint, Tukaram Maharaj. He was asked that when we do Namasparan, when we do japa, the mind wanders. What to do? He says, let the mind wander. Why do you wander with it? So the idea is, it sounds very simple, but the problem is that we identify with the mind so much that we just get carried away by it. But if you become a little more introspective, okay, this is the mind saying this, I don't necessarily have to get to go along with it. Then we'll be able to better protect ourselves. So getting out of the way means making sure that the mind doesn't come in the way of our connection with Krishna. Thank you. Yes, please.
I have one question. Yeah. It's been like month and 2 months we have it. Okay. Me and my husband, we always talk about the question. Somebody told us you have to introduce Krishna or Bhagavad Gita to other people too. And we asked them how we represent the Bhagavad Gita to other people. Mm-hmm. But we have to tell them like their God is good, but our God is like Krishna is the main God, right? We always said that. How we can tell other people like this is the Bhagavad Gita, you read this book, this is everything. Like we know we read the book, we know we have all the question answered in the book.
Okay.
But how we can tell other people
this is like, okay, that's a good question. So how can we introduce the Bhagavad Gita to other people? See, generally, we have to recognize where people are at. And we have to look at what their needs are. And based on that, we present the Bhagavad Gita's wisdom accordingly. So, for example, if I go to companies, then they are not interested in religion and God. In fact, they want to be secular. So there, we present the Bhagavad Gita as a book on mindfulness, on managing our mind, on learning to manage our emotions, our impulses, our mind. And the Bhagavad Gita talks extensively about the mind. So if we can manage our mind better, then we can connect with people better. So then we can present Krishna not as a religious God, but as the object of meditation. So you can talk about the Bhagavad Gita as a book of mindfulness and meditation, which helps us understand our mind. If you're talking with parents, can talk about how the Bhagavad Gita helps us can help us to form good impressions on our children. You know, we all want our children to grow up with good citizens. So reciting the Gita, understanding the Gita, that by that you can pass on good impressions to your children. If you're talking to people who are already devoted, as you said, to some other God, then we have to have an inclusive understanding. It's not that there are many gods, there is one God. And it is not that if they are worshipping some god and we are telling them to worship another god. They're not shifting their devotion. They're simply evolving in their understanding of devotion. Srila Prabhupada would say that when he would talk about Krishna Bhakti to even people who are, say, from a Christian background. He didn't tell, I have come here to convert you. He said that if generally, if you consider there are some people who are nominal religionists, and they're just born in a Christian family, say, or born in a particular particular religious tradition, but they're not actually practicing much. So for them, Prabhupada would say that this, the Bhagavad Gita gives a systematic knowledge of God, and you can connect with God much faster by understanding the Bhagavad Gita. So it's like, for those who are already on a spiritual path, there's the bottom of the mountain and there's the top of the mountain. And there are different paths up the mountain. We don't say that this is the only path. But this is a path which we have found especially effective. Interesting. The test is that does our consciousness rise? Do we become more attached to the spiritual? And do we become more less dependent and more detached from worldly infatuations? If that is happening, then we are on the progressive spiritual path. And if somebody is already committed to a particular religious path, then you can say that this can give you a broad understanding of spirituality by which actually you can practice your spiritual tradition better. So Prabhupada would say that a Christian can become a better Christian by studying the Bhagavad Gita. So we are not talking about converting people horizontally from one tradition to another tradition. The purpose of the Bhagavad Gita is to elevate one's consciousness from being materialists to becoming spiritualists. So according to people's interest, we can connect. If somebody has lost a loved one, then we can tell them about how your loved one is not lost actually. They're eternal. They're still living. And how the soul lives beyond death, that you can understand from the Bhagavad Gita. If somebody is very discouraged in their lives, then we can talk about how Arjuna was discouraged at the start of the Gita. But by the end of the Gita, Arjuna became encouraged. So Arjuna's Gandiva bow, which he had put aside, that can represent our enthusiasm, our determination. And we might just put it aside. I can't fight. I can't do it. But the Bhagavad Gita's knowledge, if you understand, just as Arjuna became enlivened and picked up his bow in readiness to fight, similarly, we can also be understanding the Bhagavad Gita when we understand our own eternality, when we understand God's love for us, then that becomes a source of inexhaustible energy for us. And thus, we can again become enlivened. So, the Bhagavad Gita offers us a broad map for life. And then we can understand by studying the Bhagavad Gita where we are and how to progress forward in our life.
I gave it to somebody, like the Bhagavad Gita yesterday, and she was like, same thing you said, as somebody lost some loved one, right? Mm. And the same thing happened with her, and I don't know if I said right or wrong, I told her, don't read this book as a religion, just start read, and you're going to have your old answers, whatever, because she's really upset, for it's been months, that's she's crying all the time at work, and yesterday I took the Bhagavad Gita, I told her, I said, I don't want her to be changed your religion or anything. Don't think this is the religion book. Just read as is. You're all the answer in this book. Just read it as a answer book. I don't know if I say right or wrong.
That's very good, yeah. So, there's a large number of people who identify themselves as SBNR. This is spiritual but not religious.
But I feel bad. I said, so, I don't know, it's a religion book.
And no, see how it is. Can you say that Bhagavad Gita is not a religious book? It depends on what you mean by the words. See, certain words acquire certain connotations according to context. So the word religion somehow is acquired a narrow as a negative context in today's world. It refers to narrow-mindedness, bigotry, violence, superstition. So people have all those ideas when they use the word religion. Whereas when they use the word spiritual, they have open-mindedness, a willingness to experience something higher in life. And it has a very positive connotation. So now if you look at the Bhagavad Gita's mood overall, it does give us a broad understanding of the nature of reality. And then it gives us an understanding of the various paths to navigate the territory of reality. So in that sense, it's a spiritual book. Now, is it a religious book? Yes, it is definitely a religious book in the sense that it is followed by primarily by the practitioners of a particular religion. But actually, if we consider the Hindu tradition, there was a court case in the Indian Supreme Court, they try to define what is Hinduism, because they had to decide whether a particular group of people are Hindu or not. And then there is the broad Hindu tradition is so inclusive that the Supreme Court came to a conclusion that anybody in India who is not a Christian, a Muslim, a Jain, a Buddhist, an atheist, a Parsi, that is a Hindu. So actually the Bhagavad Gita is very inclusive that way. So according to context, if you say it's not a religious book in the sense that it is not a narrow-minded book, it is not a book that will foster bigotry or violence. Okay. Yes. Yes, you had a question? Yeah.
I was just
okay. Yeah, we'll come back. Yeah.
I was just wondering if you can give some tips to, you know, this identification of this mind is very controlled by these modes of nature. So sometimes the modes are overtaken, you know.
How do we
remain persistent?
Okay, how do we identify the mind? Because the modes carry us away. Yes, it's true. And I'll give a disclaimer. I also identify with my mind. So it's a universal problem. But broadly, I would say that there are 3-4 things which help. One is that identifying what are the broad patterns in which the mind distracts us. Although the mind may distract us in many ways, but they have broad patterns. Say if one thing goes wrong, then the mind starts telling a sorry story and everything is going to go wrong. Your life is rotten. And then what happens? The mind starts making us feel pessimistic or depressed. So then what we can do is, it's one very good, very easy or very effective way to distance ourselves from the mind is to treat the mind like another person. So treat the mind like another person. That means, say, if in our life, some people are very pessimistic, they always speak negative. Now, as soon as they start speaking negative, what do we do? We get carried away by the negativity. If we are in a close relationship with them and we can't just walk away, then we'll hear them, but we won't get carried away. We'll try to console them. We'll try to encourage them. So what we need to do is, okay, as soon as the mind starts telling, oh, life is terrible, then we can just say, oh, okay, now the mind has started the self-pity story. Or the mind has started now the resentment story. The mind has started the greed story. The mind has started whatever. We can actually identify the typical stories which the mind tells. And then whenever that story starts, at that time we'll be able to catch it. Okay, this is the mind starting the story. So a further step with this is that whenever we feel any emotion, I'm feeling angry, so saying that, just put, the mind is saying, I'm feeling angry. The mind is saying, I'm feeling angry. It's a simple exercise, but if you do it, it actually is quite effective. I sometimes, if I'm after traveling from one place to another, and I start feeling very tired. I just can't do anything, I'm tired. This is, the mind is saying, I'm tired. Oh, the mind is saying. Yeah, does the thought actually regenerate some energy? And then don't just say it in the mind. Because what is said in the mind will be carried away by the mind. Just speak it aloud. Don't need to proclaim to everyone. Just verbalize it. The mind is saying, I'm tired. Oh, okay. Now we can't wish away what the mind is saying, but we can process it. Okay, sometimes we may be tired, but still we have some capacity. I can work for some more time. Sometimes we may be so tired that we just have to take some rest, take a break. That's fine. But what generally, when any thought, desire, emotion comes up within us, we tend to we think I have only two options to it, to deal with it. Either it express it or repress it. So I'm feeling angry, either I express the anger or I repress the anger. But we have a third option, that is process. So as soon as we can identify, the mind is saying I'm angry, then it is like somebody else is telling I'm angry. Then okay, what happened? Please tell me. Then when they hear it, okay, even this is then we can, after they hear it and we discuss with them, we help them process it. So just by putting this, the mind is saying, what happens by that, we can process it.
Among this, the super soul communicates, okay. How do you distinguish
between this? Okay, that's a separate question. I'll come to that in later. But one last point I would say. Third is that, in general, we can try to create some kind of pause button for ourselves. The mind operates on urgency. The mind gives urges. You know, you have to do this and you have to do this right now. And saying no to the mind is extremely difficult. But if we can do something which absorbs our consciousness, channels our consciousness. So when we feel something, some urge coming up, we may chant Hare Krishna a few times. We may, if we like some kirtan, just hear that kirtan for a few times. Or if we have read some verses in the Bhagavad Gita or some wisdom quotes, we keep them ready with us and read them. So get something by which you can pause yourself. Even just breathing deeply, going out for a walk, just working out the energy within us, that can also help us. So we have to find out what will work as a pause button for us. And once we develop that pause button, we'll find that distancing ourselves from the mind will become much easier. Okay. And now, what about the super soul speaking within us? It's very difficult to know when some voice comes within us, who is speaking? Is it the mind? Is it the intelligence? Is it the ego? Is it the super soul? What is it? So generally, the reliable way to process this is, don't worry about where it is coming from. Focus on where it is taking us. Where it is taking me. That means if I act this way, if someone says, this person is so irresponsible, you know, I have to give this person a piece of my mind. That will put them in their place. Then they will learn. Now, we may feel that actually, it's very, very dangerous to think that we are doing God's work on His behalf. That means, we yell at someone, and why? You know, you deserve to become humble, and I'm making you humble. No, that doesn't work like that. So generally, rather than thinking of that our particular desire or impulse or whatever is coming from Krishna or the super soul, we should think that, don't worry where it is coming from, focus on where it's going to take me. And if by our intelligence, by experience, we understand, you know, yelling at this person is going to make things worse, or indulging in this impulse is not going to improve things, then better pause yourself. Okay. Thank you. Yes, there's a question behind. Yeah. Yes, sir. Hare Krishna.
Yes, sir. As an extension to Mataji's question, she was asking how to explain to others. So if we meet a Shaivite who strongly believes that Shiva is the supreme, do we need to explain to them or just keep quiet and
okay?
Repeat.
What is the problem?
Yeah. So if we meet somebody who is a Shaivite, a worshipper of Lord Shiva, do we explain to them or just offer them our good wishes and move on? We have to be clear about our purpose. Our purpose is to elevate people's consciousness. Our purpose is not to just convert people to become our followers or even to increase the ranks of a particular organization. Now, different people are at different levels in their spiritual journey. And based on where they are at, they will have different levels of receptivity. So the first thing when we connect with anyone is that we need to give them the conviction or at least the openness to the inclination, the indication that we are their well-wishers. If they start feeling we are proselytizers, we are out there to convert them to our form of worship, then their defenses will close down. So we need to basically give them a positive experience. So if somebody is a worshipper of Lord Shiva, we can focus more on the principle that they are religious and they are worshipping. In today's world, how many people actually worship any higher being? Most people are materialistic today. So if somebody is already devoted, that is also a very significant sign of their piety and their receptivity to broad spirituality. So even if there are 99% difference between us and another person, we should start with the 1% commonality. If we start with the 99% difference, then there's no chance of connection. So if somebody is worshipping Lord Shiva, then appreciate them that they are pious, appreciate that they are devoted. And then tell, generally speaking, if we connect with them at a personal level, that means we just appreciate them as human beings, appreciate their piety, and we may tell them based on their interests that yes, the Bhagavad Gita is a systematic understanding of the whole spiritual journey. You can join a Bhagavad Gita class. Please come here. You get a systematic understanding of what we are doing. So we have to first create faith in them. And then at the right time, the particular faith that they may have, that may need to be re-examined. We can't start that journey at the first interaction itself. When Srila Prabhupada came to India, and this is, I was mentioning about Giriraj Maharaj's books, I've been talking extensively with him. When Prabhupada came to India, at that time, whether it was 1960s, before he left for America, or 1970s, when he came back from America with his Western followers, Indians themselves had not changed dramatically. And even in 1970s, not many Indians became dedicated followers of Srila Prabhupada. So Prabhupada encouraged them to become life members. And almost every Indian that Prabhupada went to connected with, they went to their homes, they all had their altars. And they had their particular set of various images in their homes. Prabhupada would not comment on that. Prabhupada would just speak Bhagavad Gita, speak Krishna consciousness, and he would give them his books. And he would encourage them to come to temples. And gradually by that, many of them became more and more favorable. And some of them became more committed. So if we get into an argument, oh, you know, Shiva is not supreme, Krishna is supreme, then we may just actually antagonize them. One is that they may quote this scripture, that scripture, we quote this scripture, that scripture. And we can, based on scripture, try to establish certain points. But for many people, the object of worship is not an object of logic. It is more an object of emotion. So that's why if we try to use logic, it's like a wrong weapon. It will hurt them. It will not transform them. So therefore, the important thing is that we connect them with them at a personal level. And after connecting with them at a personal level, we find out how we can best serve them. If we antagonize them too much and they become offensive to devotees, or devotees are such fanatical people, then what is happening with Krishna devotees? They are actually committing offenses to Krishna, offenses to Krishna's devotees. And we are damaging their spiritual prospects by that. If worse still, they think, oh, you know, this religious path is very complicated. Some people say this is God, some people say that is God, and better I'll not get involved in this one. And then they become atheists by that. Then what have we done? We have done disservice to them. So our purpose should be to encourage them to rise higher. So how we can do that? That we will have to see according to time, place, circumstance. Na buddhi bhedam janayet agyanam karma sanginam joshayet sarva karmani vidvan yuktah samachara. Not disturb people's mind, Krishna says. Just engage them in a way that they will get gradually elevated. So, and if we don't make it an issue, most people don't make it an issue also. That means, if you see, broadly speaking, Indians are more interested in worship than the object of worship. They're more interested. Even that means they'll go to a temple and they will close their hands and pray for 5 minutes. And they'll come out and ask you, they will ask, you know, who was there on the altar? So the act of worship for them is more important than the object of worship. And if no person who is from a Indian background will usually say that Krishna is not God. It is only when we tell them that only Krishna is God, that is when the problem comes up. But that doesn't have to be told initially. that can evolve gradually. So if we just connect with people and help them to appreciate Krishna Bhakti, appreciate the philosophy, and gradually they will evolve. What we need is intelligence and patience. We can't expect to, our agenda should also be pure. It's not our, we shouldn't have an agenda that I want to convert people. Our agenda is that we want to help people rise in their spiritual journey. And for some people, it may be that they are not yet ready for worshipping Krishna, and they're worshipping Shiva. You know, Shiva is also a great devotee, and he will also guide them upwards. So there are stories where those who worship Lord Shiva purely, they became devoted to Krishna. Like there's this story of Vallabhacharya. Vallabhacharya used to worship both Shiva and Krishna. And one day, in a mood of great devotion, he worshipped Lord Shiva. And then Lord Shiva appeared in front of him. He says, "What do you want?" And because he had such an intense devotional experience, he says, "Give me that which is dearest to you. Give me that which you think is best for me." And when he prayed like this, Lord Shiva blessed him and gave him a form of Lord Krishna to worship. So we shouldn't think that they are misled and we have to get them on the right track. It is that Lord Shiva is also their guide. And if they are very confused, and if they themselves bring the issue, is Krishna supreme or Lord Shiva supreme, then you can pray to them. You pray to Lord Shiva, "Please guide me forwards." And Lord Shiva will guide them. There are devotees in our movement who were worshippers of Lord Shiva, and they prayed to Shiva, "Please guide me." And as they got that understanding, that intuition, and now they are devoted to Krishna. So we don't have to see that, you know, I, in my small interaction with them for a few minutes or a few hours, I am going to convert them. We have to see that there's a bigger plan, and I am just one aid in their journey. So let me aid in the best way possible for them. Did that answer your question? Thank you. So, should we stop here?
That's okay.
So, thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki. Gaur Bhakti.